This is the Sports Timeout Podcast with CJ Perry, Tony Caronco, Tristen Howe, and your host, Wes Underwood.
It's that time again, everyone. Welcome to the Sports Timeout Podcast, brought to you by Jefferson's and Crack and Cajun Seafood House in Joplin. And, well, if you're in the mood for some fresh Cajun, head on over to Crack and Cajun Seafood House in Joplin, across from Moe's on Main Street. And if you're in the mood for some wings, head on over to Jefferson's behind Books a Million on Rangeline. Wes Underwood, along with Tony and Tristen, and, CJ out once again, and we're going to get started. I mean, nothing good but a George Strait concert. Got some George Strait music in the background as we came in here, and yeah. Good concert this week. You guys have a good week?
I did.
Yeah.
Good. Ready to talk some sports?
Of course.
All right. Well, here's one that's going to throw you. We're going to open up in the National Women's Soccer League, and we will talk the Kansas City Current. They look phenomenal after a rough start in their match with Orlando this past Sunday, as they gain a 2-point lead for the sixth spot in the standings in the NWSL. But a bigger story, as they make a push to their postseason, a bigger story on top of that is that the expansion race for National Women's Soccer is heating up. And as women's soccer is booming this year, they have added two teams in Angel City FC and the San Diego Wave FC. And then two more teams will be added in 2024, as Utah and one other team will be in play for the 2024 season. They tried to get it for next year, but things didn't happen right. But they are excited to get them in 2024. But this being said, also, the league is under pressure to get things moving, as they want teams being set up for success and not for failure, which, understandable. I mean, you're coming in here very low on the totem pole in the sports world for soccer. And I mean, here you are moving to the heartland and then across the United States, getting some other places, trying to get up in Utah. I mean, you just brought in Angel City FC and San Diego Wave. So, I mean, it's off to a good start, but is this a good thing, do you guys think, and will it happen? And Tristen, we'll go ahead and begin with you.
Yeah, I think, you know, when it comes to women's sports, I think we need to look at it a little bit more, especially women's soccer, because, you know, players like Alex Morgan and, you know, Julie Ertz, you know, they're very good at what they do, and I think that they don't get the recognition that they deserve. So for them to add a couple more teams by 2024 and hopefully make the league bigger, I'd like to see a lot more news about women's sports come around in 2024.
Yeah. Tony, your thoughts?
Yeah. So personally, I mean, they're going to struggle just like the WNBA does for ratings and stuff, which is unfortunate, but really ultimately who needs to support the women's sport is women, because if you look at who supports, you know, men's sports in general, it's men. The overwhelming majority of people that have watched sports nowadays in men's sports overall is men. Women need to, you know, rally behind, you know, these fine athletes and, you know, support them as well. I'm not saying we shouldn't take, you know, do our part and watch it, but, you know, there's not a whole lot of support from other women. So I think if we can get more women interested in, you know, following, you know, professional sports for women, I think your ratings would go up tremendously, because that's half of the population that doesn't watch men's sports to begin with, for the most part.
Agreed. And on that,
yeah, note, I can get behind that one.
Yeah. Yeah, and definitely. And continuing, we will head to the MLB. And as promised, this week we talked deals. Monday was active. Tuesday up until 5 p.m. was crazy. I mean, my phone was blowing up. Yankees load up on pitching, hitting, and fielding. I mean, they get pitchers in Luke Trevino and Frankie Montas from the A's, which is, you know, these guys right here. That's why I wore it for you, Tristen. I mean, they sent you some good guys. And then Scott Efros from the Cubs, he's coming over. He played last night, and he threw a good inning or two. And then Andrew Benintendi earlier this week. And then they go and grab Harrison Bader yesterday from the Cardinals. And then some other notables: Padres pick up closer Josh Hader. man, that's going to be a great addition to their bullpen. Hosmer goes to the Red Sox. Man, Hosmer's going around, and I'm kind of glad he's there with the Red Sox. And then the Phillies grab Syndergaard from the Angels, and then the Astros pick up first baseman and outfielder Trey Mancini and catcher Christian Velasquez. So good there. And then the Cardinals obviously dealt Bader to the Yankees, but they also pick up Jordan Montgomery, who's a phenomenal arm. And they also pick up Jose Quintana. And Quintana is going to be an arm to see as well as Montgomery. So the Cardinals doing the right things at the right time this year. I saw some posts saying that they don't usually do that, but here they are being aggressive. I like the moves there for them. Padres also pick up Soto and Bell. So there's where Soto went. And then the Twins, grab all-star closer Jorge Lopez. And yeah, I mean, that's pretty good get from Baltimore there. I mean, the guy made the all-star team this year and has had a phenomenal season in the pen. And then my Royals are reloading the bullpen as they pick up Weaver from the Diamondbacks. Then they grab Minchevich from Seattle. And then yesterday they traded Merrifield to Toronto for an arm and a multi-tool player who could be very good in the near future. I like these trades. Tristen, how are you feeling about the Yankees?
I'm feeling pretty good about the Yankees. I like the fact that they're really bringing in a lot more depth. Whether or not a lot of these guys stay at the major league level, it'd be good to, you know, even send them down to AAA, AA, you know, get a lot more experience in, and you know, possibly get better at the game, and then bring them up. You know, you mentioned earlier, Wes, that they're adding a lot of pitchers in the bullpen, which is good. You know, it's always good to have a good rotation of pitchers. Any day of the week. So, you know,
Chapman isn't doing his job.
Yeah, I mean, and even still, the Yankees are still one of the best teams in the league right now. And to add a lot more depth to there, you know, it's only, I mean, the sky's the limit at this point for the Yankees. Yeah. They, you know, you could arguably say that they won the first half of this season, but they've got to finish strong.
They do.
You know, it's been quite some time since the World Series championships went to the Bronx. So I'm really hoping the Yankees can pull one out, and hopefully the Dallas Cowboys can pull one out, but I'm not going to hold my breath on that one.
All right. We're talking baseball here. Tony, you got anything here?
So something interesting that I saw, well, actually that I heard about, was that one of the players from the Mariners got traded over to the Astros.
Yeah.
In like mid game, he found out. He's like, "Hey, how does it make you feel that you just got traded?" So I was like, "Huh?" And he literally just found out while he was playing. And he's like, "Well, I guess I'm going over there." He just walks over to the other dugout. He puts on his new jersey and he played for the Astros that night.
Huh. That's crazy. So
man, I just found that little.
I mean, that's how Whit Merrifield felt for the Royals last night. He was put in the starting lineup, and then ESPN had to go in and say, cancellation of lineup, we're redoing it. And as he got traded to Toronto, another fun fact out of that is he was one of the Royals players who couldn't go to Toronto because he wouldn't get vaccinated. So I'm anxious to see how that works out. It's not going to be good if he gets vaccinated, because then all of his – teammates are gonna be, or ex-teammates now are gonna be like, what, huh? But now we go ahead and head into the NFL and we talk Watson's punishment. Look, I will say I was a little shocked it wasn't longer, but here's the deal. He will serve a 6-game suspension without pay as of now, but will be fined for violating the league's personal conduct policy following accusations of sexual misconduct. Disciplinary officer Sue L. Robinson ruled that on Monday, but the NFL Players Association and the league have until Thursday, so tomorrow at 9 a.m. Eastern, to file a written appeal of Robinson's ruling. In a statement Sunday night that was brought out, and the union made it clear that it will stand by her decision and urge the NFL to do the same. So, I mean, the league, said that in a statement on Monday, and it was determining the next steps. And I mean, it kind of goes to Roger Goodell here, and that's a guy who's been pretty tough on some people lately. Do you guys think this will uphold, or do you think it will change? Tony, we'll go you.
The only way I see it changing is it's changing for the worse for Deshaun Watson. You know, I think everybody's talked about it. You know, Ridley, yeah, who got suspended for a year for gambling on a game that he wasn't even participating in, you know, and he lost. You know, it wasn't like he gambled for a game, you know, and he threw the game. No, they lost. And not only did he lose money, but he's getting suspended for a year, so he's losing money twice. Yeah. So to me, the fact that they're handling the sexual misconduct, you know, they're being easier on that versus what it was gambling, inside gambling that didn't
make
turn
you wonder.
Well.
Makes you wonder.
Yeah, I think the NFL is super corrupt. I think they do a lot of things very badly. I'm very, very disappointed in the NFL for both situations. Do I think Deshaun Watson should be suspended right now? No, I don't, because he hasn't been found guilty for anything. Yeah. But if he is, I do think they should, you know, they should throw him everything. I think he should even play in the league whatsoever if he is found guilty, and have him have to pay back the money. That's how I would handle it personally if I was running the NFL. But, you know, for some reason, I'm not.
Tristen?
No, I totally agree with Tony on this one. You know, 10, 15 years ago, the league threw players out of the league for way lesser crimes. And to touch on Tony's point, he settled, I think as of yesterday, he settled all of those lawsuits. You know, and settling and found not guilty are two different things.
Yeah.
And so as you know, someone that's not in the league or has nothing to do with the politics that has to do with the NFL. 20 plus women came out and said that this guy did this. I mean,
yeah.
I remember after the Giants won Super Bowl 42, they kicked Plaxico Burress out of the league for shooting himself in the leg by accident.
Yep.
They kicked Josh Gordon out for marijuana possession and smoking marijuana all the time. Yeah. I mean, it doesn't make sense. And I do believe the NFL is really corrupt, especially with this whole situation, because I feel as a fan of the NFL, there's a piece to the puzzle missing, and I feel like the NFL really doesn't want to disclose that information.
Yeah. Yeah.
So I think personally, he's already.
Oh, no.
That's my hard take on the situation.
We lost you there for a second. So, but yeah, I agree. Next in the NFL, we talk Deebo Samuel. And after all the speculation of him wanting out this offseason, and even on Twitter, you know, posting some conflicting issues with the 49ers, and well, here they are expanding him 3 years into 2025 on a $73 million deal, with $58 million of that guaranteed. 58. That's a big number out of that contract. First off, should he get this after what he said in the offseason, and why, Tony?
Sorry, repeat that. I got a phone call in the middle of that. Repeat that again.
Yeah, Deebo Samuel, after everything in the offseason, I mean, posting some stuff on Twitter with conflicting issues of his contract, at one point deleted the 49ers, but then brought him back. And then they end up extending him 3 years into 2025, giving him a $73 million deal with $58 million of that guaranteed. Should he get this after what he said and what he did the offseason, and why?
No. I'm not saying – no, because of what he said in the offseason. I just think he's a little bit more injury prone than you would like him to be.
Yeah.
So I think it obviously doesn't help his case, but you know, maybe they see something in him that we don't. I think he's a spectacular, you know, athlete, you know, overall. But personally, I think that he needs, you know, again, we talk about, you know, these people that play for the NFL just being ungrateful for the amount of money that they're getting to play a game, a child's game, you know, ultimately. To me, I'd be blessed to play for an NFL team. I think 99% of the world that doesn't play for the NFL would agree with that.
Yeah.
You know, so I think it's childish. I think he's immature. And, you know, I don't see him being very successful in his career. You know, whenever you have an ego that big, you know, it never goes well for anybody.
Yeah. Wholeheartedly agree, Tristen.
Yeah. You know, like Tony said, you know, Kyler Murray did the same thing, you know, during the offseason. He unfollowed the Arizona Cardinals. They ended up re-signing him. So at this point, obviously, it doesn't matter what he says on social media. They're going to, you know, look at him from an athletic standpoint and say that, you know, Deebo Samuel is arguably.
Did that happen? I want proof. I want proof. Did Kyler Murray do that?
I did, actually. I did a little Instagram stalking and found the facts.
Okay.
Deebo Samuel, he's an exceptional talent. But obviously, when it comes to social media drama, you know, no one cares because obviously someone gave Antonio Brown a second chance. And no one really cared about that. So, $58 million, I'd say he probably deserves it based off of his athletic ability. But, you know, when it comes to being, you know, a drama queen and injury prone, like Tony said, you know, the 49ers are obviously taking a chance on him. He's not taking a chance on the 49ers. So, you know, if he gets hurt or whatever, then they lose out of that money. But overall, I do think Deebo is, you know, he's a great wide receiver, probably top 10 in the league. You know, arguably, but yeah, I mean, stay off social media, man. stay off the social media, because overall, these players, they're going to end up ruining their careers based off of what they said. They're going to say something entirely wrong, get canceled, you know. So stay off Twitter. Take your money and leave. That's what I mean. That's how I feel about it. Take your money. All right, and leave.
Well, I'll take you off YouTube and meet you again, and take your money and leave, which is nothing. But no, I get you. Exactly. I get you. No, nobody probably wants to hear us talk about all this anyway, but, you know, we do what we do. And lastly, we talked about the Dolphins, and boy, did it all fall apart pretty quick. I mean, they go get Hill this offseason and everything else that happened, but as a 6-month investigation with tampering has been undeveloped, and the owner and VP had illegal conversations with Tom Brady and Sean Payton from 2019 to 2022. The NFL stripped the Dolphins of their 2023 first-round draft pick and their 2024 third-round draft pick for violating the integrity of the game. And the Dolphins owner, Stephen Ross, is also suspended through October 17th and was fined $1.5 million. First Flores, and now this, do you guys see it as the right punishment, and does it affect the season, Tristen?
Yeah, I agree with it, mostly because if I do recall, the whole Brian Flores situation was, you know, over racism or, you know, I haven't, you know, read up on it here recently. But, you know, with the way the world is in today's day and age, you know, racism needs to, you know, come out in the open, and we need to, you know, find out about everybody doing this sort of thing. And I mean, racism's just not cool, and especially with someone trying to just make it in the league as a head coach. Why give the guy hate when, you know, he's just trying to make it? I totally agree with the punishment. You know, the racism doesn't just not belong in the league. It doesn't belong anywhere at all. So you know, for the NFL to actually put some sort of justice into it, you know, praise to them, even though I kind of just said they were corrupt earlier. But
yeah,
you know, for this specific situation, you know, good on them for, you know, bringing it out into the open, throw out a punishment there, and hopefully, you know, we can bring this sort of thing to a stop.
Tom Brady and Sean Payton quotes. What do you think on that situation, Tony?
To me, it probably just – there's a lot more of this going on throughout the league.
Yeah.
You know, I don't think that them, you know, this is just, you know, something small that they caught, and, you know, it probably got leaked out somewhere or another. I think there's a lot more corruption, you know, going through the league, and this is just something small that the league is trying to cover up, you know, to kind of show that they're progressive and kind of to try to show that they are, you know, on top of things with when in reality they're probably the most corrupt organization in the country. I'll take that back, but they're very corrupt.
And on that note, we will now head into the local sports update brought to you by Trackside Burgers. And the Webb City 12U baseball team is heading to Indy after winning the Missouri state title. Check out my interview this week as I sat down with one of the players heading to Indy. And I bring in Brody Jackson from that team. How are you, son?
I'm good. How are you?
Feels weird calling you Sonny, but that's the only thing I can come up with here. But you guys, I'm good. How's the team in general?
Team's going good. We've been practicing a lot lately.
That's awesome. Good things to come out of that practice, I would hope. I mean, you guys accomplished a big feat this season last week as you became Missouri state champs and punched a ticket to Indiana. How does that feel?
Feels great. You know, a lot of teams don't get to do this. A lot of teams don't get to go to regional tournament.
Mm-hmm. And you had a home run in that game. What went through your head after that happened?
Yeah, and as soon as it hit the bat, I just knew it was gone. And it just feels great knowing that I helped the team out.
It's awesome. And you guys, your generation does these little dances. Did you do your home run dance when you got to the plate?
Yeah. Yeah.
What's that celebration look like?
You know, I went and I was pumped up coming around third base. You know, I jumped on home plate. Yep.
Fortnite dance?
No.
No? Okay. What are you most excited about heading into Indiana?
I'm most excited about getting to stay in a hotel with our friends and just the experience staying in a hotel with all these different states.
It's awesome. And you guys play this Friday at 12 Central. You all have some fundraising to do. How can fans help today and tomorrow to help with that extra push towards your expenses?
Yeah, you can go to our Facebook page and you can donate through Venmo.
Awesome. And before we go, we here at the Sports Timeout Podcast would like to congratulate you guys on this and wish you luck and safe travels, and congratulations again. Good luck.
Thanks for having me on.
Again, congrats to them and good luck. And we pitched in the best we could here on the show. And Tony, do you have anything else before we head out?
September 17th, Buffalo Run is having some fights, but that is also the day that Tristen is getting married. So congratulations to our boy Tristen. We won't be at your wedding. We will be at the fights.
Show the rings. Show the rings.
Dude, I gave you an invitation.
Where's I'm mine? Just
well, I just you know you can come.
All is well. That's awesome. That's exciting.
Yeah, there are some fights at Buffalo Run September 17th. Okay. A lot of the Mosberg guys are going to be fighting on that card. Yes. Few of the Heartland guys are on that card. There's a lot of local fighters fighting. It's going to be a fun fight. Unfortunately, I probably won't be there because I'll be with my buddy Tristen.
Yeah. And on that note, we finish out with the 2-minute warning brought to you by Hot Stone Pizzeria. And it's dead week here in the four states. Football, all sports, everybody's off this week. Things start getting heavy next week. I mean, football season starts next week, too, for the NFL preseason. Pretty soon, college football is going to be starting up, too. So we're going to be talking some football. So be ready for that. And, well, of course, all of these games and events are pending the weather and the current flu and COVID-19 situation. So tune in to each team's social media pages for times and updates. And the music is here. This is the end of another episode for Tony, Tristen, CJ, and myself. Have a great and safe rest of your week, and we hope you enjoy your weekend. Enjoy some sports. Support the Web City Little League 12U team. And, yeah, take care. See you all next week.
See you.
Covering that continually. And...